through our program. Now we will start subject related to industrial use of the multimedia wiki, and it will be an interesting talk. And just before Alexander starts with his talk about industrial wiki, I don't know if you all have the sheet with the manual and so on. You can still choose, so if you haven't done so, just try to get your choice on the sheet. So the next talk is Industrial Wiki by Alexander Grimm, and looking forward to hearing from you.
Okay, so thanks, Carsten, for Industrial Wiki. I'd like to share some insights of the project we started 2 years ago. It's about this little device. So, are there any makers? You can see this is a Raspberry Pi. We were thinking about, okay, how can we use the technology we are using at the internet also for industrial use cases? And there's a reason why we started doing this. If you're wondering why this is X to be before, so all the other producers of the type. This year we had the first public visibility of the wiki talk at Stadium Computer Fair, and we were thinking about, okay, how can you present something like an industrial wiki? And created this little Mindstorm Lego robot. Anyway, that's something I'll tell you later. My plan was to bring this here to give you a live demo, but I was afraid that maybe I had some issues at the airport security. So a proposal is also if community lights can bring us and probably from next year to Regensburg, and then it might be easier to do something like this. So anyway, we also got an award this year for the idea. Industry. I mean, industry is really like the everyday car technology that you get from car racing. If you're working for industry, you have definitely different challenges than you have working for office workers, real time, where you have limited resources, and so on. So that was our driving thing to get the feedback out from what we learned from this project and bring it back into kind of robots. So what are we doing normally? We are automating knowledge intensive processes for our customers. For example, getting rid of extra workflows and these kind of things in simplification. So we really have data management stuff, we do mass data management, data cleaning, data integration with ETL tools and so on. We have business intelligence tools. Most often we use open source software. Here we have also enterprise wikis, there's the area where media wiki comes in. And on the right hand side, we do knowledge engineering as well, so industrial knowledge management and so on. So this is our field of work. Some projects we are working on, I thought this is just to highlight a few points. If you take a look what we did there, is classical systems in office. You have some knowledge management system, you have quality management handbooks, you have some for campaign management, cloud automation is something we are working on. This is completely office world. But if you're on events like events on people are going to say, hey, that's great what you're doing, but we are a manufacturing company, how to connect top loading machines to what you already did. So if you take a look at how a process map in a company could look like, they have typically this area like management processes, core processes, supporting processes, and the areas that are marked here, these are areas where typically no one would expect a wiki software. Like here is this developing stuff, really production, top floor. This is closed rooms, cleaning rooms stuff. No one would think about in a wooden there. And especially not attached to machines, it's definitely a different story. So, the customer talks of, hey, isn't there a way to make this layer, the top floor, connected to the vision we have, for example, for quality management? And a good question is, why should this be integrated? Because in this area, there are some very specialized systems like ERP systems, MES, or manufacturing execution systems. These are really closed systems, highly specialized, but they are also some kind of inflexible, so it's hard to get data out of it and so on, very expensive. So there is some need to get the data access to the data. So I collected some thoughts from discussions we had with people. So they said, we need to automate the IT process in production, for example. They said, okay, we need to have something like an end-to-end documentation for governance risk, compliance reasons, for quality management reasons. And we have more knowledge workers in production. We have high-tech machines there, so we need an engineer to work with that machine. It's less blue-collar work and more white-collar work. Things should be more adaptable. We have something like a lot size one. This is this Industry 4.0 thing. You might have heard about mass customization. That's what they did for the industry, for example. You can go to their website and build your own industry. And things like that will happen more and more in the future. And yeah, they also have that more vertical and horizontal interoperability, so working with interfaces and integration. So if you take a look at the first point, this is more for a human start in some time. So this is something like a human machine interface. I got quickly over this slide because you're aware of what Wiki can do and not. This is standard media stuff, we have the forms, that's a nice. And then some use cases for industry. We have some talks where they say, okay, can we do something like a shift book where we can change some experience between the shift? And we have issue management directly attached to the machines and to the wiki, to learn from the issues. We have interactive admin boards, reporting stuff, and so on. So there are a lot of use cases that are relevant. We create something like a dashboard, which is probably not a thing you would expect in the wiki. But that's part of the CISA demonstration we had. So, there could be some smart search, maybe called by a cluster. So if we start from everything nice, you can have interaction with the real life. That's human machine interface. Okay. But how about this area? So this is adaptability. This is more the technical configuration part. I'd like to show you some thoughts we have on this. I mean, the idea of the switch box is really like we have device settings. I mean, this is just a design study, which could look completely different depending on the use case. Maybe also Raspberry is not powerful enough. Having a database on the C card is a thing you could definitely think about twice. I mean, that's a design study to get really a low cost device that you can throw into your machine and get additional connectivity and, of course, also semantic media. So, we have a lot of data that could be interesting to also make visible in the wiki. From a bird's eye perspective, that's our standard architecture when we start explaining about this. We have these wiki boxes and they are attached at every machine. We have something like a message broker for communication between the machines and other parts. The products take more and more of an active role, like you have sensors that can give some feedback directly from product. We have service directory, factory memories. And one thing is, if you think about, okay, let's say we have 100 of these devices with dedicated weekly. So each of these devices has its own weekly instance running. You have 100 of them. You need to have something like a service directory where you can register, so you can find that number in your network. Because the idea is the machine can, so everything is self-contained. You have to manage the Wikibox directly attached to the machine. You can move it from one place to another, and it keeps its memory. It keeps its memory in form of a semantic wiki inside. So that's the reason why it needs to register in a central instance. If you take a look at what's in these wiki boxes, basically it's a semantic media wiki. It's lifecycle management monitoring and the message broker box. The red pieces, these are adapters you're writing to get all of the software integrated on the message broker. This is a very lightweight piece of software, so this is cheap to get. And lifecycle management, yeah, that's what we've seen here. That's really important because think of you have 100 of these boxes. By design, they should be cheap. I mean, this is 38 euro for the rest of the API, 60 euro for the case, and so on. So this should be very cheap. But if you need to have an engineer to update all of these boxes more or less manually, then this should become definitely expensive. So you need a smart way to update these devices. And what we're using here is the Puppet scripts and Puppet nodes. So everything installed on that box is driven by Puppet, also the installation of MediaWiki. And that also includes content in media, so that's also deployed automatically. Well, if we have humans and the machines, the interesting part is if everything could communicate, what could be a common language so that humans can run this system, control room, product, and so on, without getting the confusion of comes with everyone speaking its own language, corporate interfaces, and so on. So there is a huge protocol stack in the industry. So you have the physical layer and so on, and in the middle, interoperability and messaging, here things become really interesting because there are some standard interfaces like OPC UA, AMQP, MQTT for messaging, multiple Ethernet are broken, and these are industrial preprocessors. And on top of that, you have the semantics layer. And that's where the real fun starts, because in Germany, especially since 3 years, they're talking about Industry 4.0. Smart concepts, you can see a lot of slides about this. But if it comes to the semantics, and that's part of the concept, everything stops. So there is no common ontology. They started building one with G-class ontology, but that's in progress. It takes some years, so it's a slow process. But here's the interesting part. And, we use SMW because we'd like to have a flexible way of things changing. Like, okay, we have an ontology, like this and that. We have deployment mechanisms, we have lifecycle management, and we have the wiki way. So things could be easily adapted because nothing is here yet. Well, one thing that's important that at least we are working on at the moment is we have Ethernet here. That's okay, but in industry you have this old fashioned industrial field process, and there are some components an additional box to it to adapt to these, so you can directly hook into the machine box and get the data out there. Well, that's basically it. The plan was to bring you this little robot type. I can only show you half a minute of the movie. We made a little computer there, so you get an impression how this is working. I already said this little Lego robot is solving a Rubik's Cube. And what we did is we hacked the Lego protocol. This is a Bluetooth protocol. We took out the datagram, transferred it into the wiki box, put it into the message box, and the message box takes it and writes the information back to the wiki. So we have so you get all the information, how many groups have been sold, how long does it take, how many steps were needed, and so on. So that was the showcase. And it funny because immediately you have people at the place. Okay, how fast is this? I can do it manually and stuff. And it was really interesting to see. So no one actually was interested in the leaky box. That's important feedback. So we were really thinking about becoming a legal reseller. So that's just an impact. No, this is really fun. We have not only screens showing software, but really something interactive. Then you can have some images or something and whatever. So it's very quickly. Anyway, that are some insights. That is a project, not an off-the-shelf product. We continue working on this. Yeah. So, you can find it on YouTube. Okay, any questions?
How do you manage backup availability for these instances, these Raspberry Pi instances? What happens if one breaks down? Do you lose your data, or did you?
You mean backup, just a backup, a physical backup, or?
Yeah.
I mean, here's the simple case. You have the T-card and the Sonnet sign. You can also attach a SD card, for example. So this is just one case here. It could be different. And the thing is, you see this temporary memory. So what we do is, if there is a data update, this is thrown in the message bus. Mm-hmm. And the local wiki takes this message to make a local store, because it could be self-contained so that it can move it around.
Okay.
The second thing is, this red message bus also gets out of the box, so the factory memory can also take this message, like the master brain.
Okay.
So the factory memory knows about the complete history of the complete factory. So even if your machine has moved out of the factory, you still know, okay, we had from this time to that time that machine, we did that data transfers and so on.
Okay.
And then happens to backup. That's the reason why we use Puppet. Puppet's used in the DevOps scene of automating IT administration tasks. What Puppet basically does is it guarantees that a device has a certain state. So you say, hey, this is my recipe, I'd like to have this with recipe and with these packages installed, with MySQL configured, these UTF data, da 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 da. Season that user, season that backup scripts. And the node guarantees that everything is installed exactly in that way.
Yeah.
So even if someone logs in, messes up your configuration, if you rerun the Puppet script, it gets recovered.
Yeah.
That's the reason why we use Puppet here. That's an important component. Otherwise, the whole architecture would not make sense.
It's cool. Yeah.
Okay.
It's really just very interesting. To what extent is something that runs through a key in any environment? What can we still do to make configuration, especially for a particular customer. How much configuration do you still need to do for a particular customer?
Yeah, I mean, that's exactly the point. I mean, without a, let's say, standard ontology, you need to have some kind of data modeling and stuff. What we do normally is the semantic absence. So we have some pieces like a person, a machine, and so on. These are the building blocks we start from, but that probably only is 60 to 70% of the solution the customer needs. So this needs some kind of customization. What we use all these schema-driven design of the pieces we deploy to the wiki. So if there are some changes, we script them and this is deployed to the wiki. So we never go to the wiki and create form and da da. This is completely scripted and automated. So this is part of the lifecycle management as well. So if you say, okay, I have this node, define a configuration, start moving from the operating system layer until the end of how the wiki should look like with CSS and everything. This is part of this Puppet and both. Okay. Yeah. I mean, I had this green box. This one. I mean, you have some identifier in the machine, because you could really go to your tablet, your URL, and then you can directly go to your product network, you can directly go to, for example, the machine interface, and you can go directly to that specific instance. Or, that's what you said, clear the service directory. So you know something, okay, you should have Ethernet machine somewhere, but I don't know where it is in my factory at the moment. Like container management, and then the container to something being moved in the factory, but you have no idea where the container actually is. So you can clear the service directory because it knows where the service directory is. They could have GPS and stuff, so you can, that's the idea of right, because you can directly attach sensors, GPS, temperature, right? So you can measure these and put this into the semantics layer. So we can really query.
Yeah, thank you, Alexander, for providing